What is electrical resistance? We already touched on this subject in the first video in this series, when we mentioned insulators and conductors. Materials impede the flow of electrical current in various ways, depending on their properties. In general, this is down to the available freedom electrons have to move within the material. Certain materials, such as metallics, have loosely bound electrons on the outer shell of their atoms. This makes them great at conducting electricity, something we explained in our first video in more detail. Aside from metallic conductors, there are also other materials that can conduct electricity. They don't have to be solid. They can also be a gas, or so-called electrolytic conductors. Think of neon and salt water, for example. Whereas other materials, such as plastics or rubbers, have tightly bound electrons. This makes the flow of electrons within these materials difficult. Materials with this property are called insulators. Nitrogen is a good example. In almost all its forms, it doesn't conduct electricity, or heat for that matter, very well. However, if you manage to heat up nitrogen sufficiently enough, it can conduct electricity as a plasma. Materials do exist in the space between conductors and insulators. These are called semiconductors. Silicon is a famous example of this. Pure silicon is not as conductive as a metal, but also not a very good insulator. Using a process called doping, specific impurities can be added to the silicon to modify its conductivity. It is the amount of opposition to the flow of electrons that determines a material's resistance. Conductors, semiconductors, insulators, resistance is a sliding scale. With conductors having low resistance and insulators very high or practically infinite resistance. For now, let's showcase resistance at work in a more practical example, an old-fashioned light bulb. Incandescent light bulbs use the heating effect of resistance to their advantage. These bulbs are filled with an inert gas, commonly argon. This gas is chemically unreactive and protects the filament from oxidation. This filament is often made from tungsten. In these bulbs, the electrical current flows through that metallic filament. Electrons moving through that material collide with the tungsten atoms. This happens billions or even trillions of times per second. These collisions excite the atoms, causing them to vibrate, which causes more collisions, which excites them even more, increasing their energy up to a point. These collisions result in an increase in temperature of the material. The benefit of tungsten is that it can get very hot without melting, helped by filling the bulb with the unreactive gas. These filaments can get so hot, in fact, that it starts giving off light. They literally glow white hot. And that's how these bulbs produce their light, but also a lot of heat. Only about 10% of the energy used by these bulbs is converted into light. The rest is lost as heat. Incandescent light bulbs rely on the filament's design to allow for a certain level of light output, based on the mains voltage it is designed for. There are no voltage limiting capabilities other than the filament's material's resistance. Incandescent light bulbs were perhaps inefficient. Their inefficiency was taken for granted, lacking more cost-effective alternatives. Inefficiency, or unwanted resistance, can also lead to problems. For example, in an electronic circuit, if an incorrect resistor is used, the device could malfunction. Or a toaster with a heating element made from a material with too much resistance could possibly take too long or fail to toast your bread. Likewise, using a toaster made for 220 volts won't work properly on 110 volts. And vice versa, a toaster made for 110 volts could be dangerous to plug into a socket with 220 volts. Too little resistance can cause dangerous situations. This is basically what short circuiting is. Another example of too much resistance would be hooking up a 9-volt battery to an incandescent light bulb. It won't do much. The bulb is designed for far higher voltages. Therefore, its filament has far too much resistance than a 9-volt battery can overcome. To illustrate, we'll approach the water wheel from the voltage video from a different angle. In that video, we adjusted our current to get things moving, keeping the wheel the same. But when approaching from the angle of resistance, we can change the size and material of our water wheel instead. If it's too big or made from a material that's too heavy and thick, our current will trickle over it, but the wheel won't move. Your 9-volt battery won't light the bulb designed for higher voltages, but electrons can still trickle through slowly. They won't heat up the filament enough, but over time the battery will empty itself nonetheless. Otherwise, if we made the water wheel from a far weaker material, paper for instance, the water current will overwhelm it and it will crumble. That's comparable to what happens in a short circuit, if too much current is forced through an electric circuit with too little resistance. In general, many devices use resistance to their advantage, striking the perfect balance between voltage, amperage, and resistance. Coffee machines, for instance, cleverly use a single heating element to heat both the water and the hot plate. And of course, we made a video about drip coffee machines. To figure out the resistance in a circuit, we use Ohm's law. This states that the resistance R is equal to the voltage V divided by the current I flowing through. The current, with I for intensity, is denoted in amps, or R is V over I. And this is Ohm's law's triangle. This visualizes that we only need to know two parts of the equation to calculate the third. Knowing the voltage and current, we can calculate the resistance. But if we instead only know the voltage and resistance, we can calculate the current. And finally, if we know the resistance and current, we can calculate the voltage. Nowadays, we are phasing out incandescent bulbs for LED bulbs. These operate at a much lower voltage than what we get from the mains, usually 220 or 110 volts, depending on where you live. LEDs produce light in a different way than incandescent bulbs. Instead of heating something until it glows, LED bulbs use electroluminescence. This process requires far less power and generates way less heat. They are more efficient, and this is also beneficial to the light bulb's lifespan. Because they require less power than the mains provide, LED bulbs have built-in current-limiting devices. This changes the incoming current from AC to DC. Then, the voltage regulator steps down the voltage from 110 or 220 volts to as low as 5 volts. We'll explain the difference between AC and DC in another video. A typical incandescent bulb could require 60 watts of power to give a useful amount of light, whereas an equally bright LED bulb uses as little as 9 to 12 watts of power. That's a significant difference in power consumption, about 80%. We'll explain watts, a unit of power, in a future video. To maintain those low voltages, LED bulbs contain small electronic components. Stepping down from the mains voltage requires so-called resistors, among other components such as capacitors, diodes, transistors, and other types. But resistors, as their name implies, are electrical components that add a certain resistance to an electrical circuit. Amongst other uses, resistors help make sure components work at the intended or at safe voltages. To sum up, voltage is basically the speed of the electric current. Amps is the amount of electric current, the intensity, if you will. And ohm is the resistance encountered by an electric current flowing through an electric circuit. Just as water flowing through a pipe can encounter resistance due to friction and other restrictions, so can electricity as it flows through an electric circuit. If you found this video helpful, help a little by giving a like and a subscribe, and click that notification bell because new videos appear irregularly. Thank you very much for watching.